Welcome to part 2 of the map sequence tutorial. In part 1 of this tutorial, we looked at how to configure a selection of steps in Automation Studio and how to start the machine process in the control application. Now we'll learn how to modify and execute the machine process at runtime via the HMI application. We want to be able to view the sequence file we created in part 1 in the HMI application. For each step, we should be able to see the name of the command and a symbolic image. To do this, we will now add and configure the sequencer widgets. A map view visualization object has already been added to my project, as you can see here. In Automation Studio, we'll navigate to the content that should display the sequencer. Then we can drag and drop the sequencer widget, which is the core element of the sequencer, onto the piece of content. The property image prefix defines the location of the images that should be displayed for the steps. The name of the image must match the name of the command in the configuration. Step item style defines how the step should be displayed. For example, if it should have a red frame and a gray background. Styles are defined in the style file and referenced in step item style. We have to define a style for every hierarchy that we created. As explained in part 1, we put all of our commands under basic, so that's the only hierarchy we need to assign a style right now. For more information, see the automation help. For MP link, we need to specify the map link of map sequence. To be able to edit the sequence at runtime, we need to add the widget sequencer edit area to the sequencer widget. Then we'll add the widget sequencer step item to the sequencer widget. This widget represents a step in the sequence and is used for each of the steps to be displayed. In the next step, we'll add some buttons. The first two buttons can be used to load and save the desired sequence. The event bindings needed to do this have already been added. A sequence file can be loaded using the load action. The file machine process we created in part 1 has been defined. An edited sequence can be saved over the original sequence using the save action. For more information about saving and loading sequences, see the automation help. The import button will be used to import the sequence, and the start button will be used to start the sequence. Again, the respective event bindings have already been added. The last thing we need to do is add a table that will allow us to select and add commands to our sequence. To do this, we'll add the sequencer table widget to the content. The number of hierarchy levels determines how many tables must be added. If the commands are all stored in a hierarchy with one level, then we need to use two tables. The first table is used to select the hierarchy, and the second to select the command. In part 1 of this tutorial, we put all our commands in the hierarchy basic, so we now need to add two instances of the sequencer table to the sequencer widget. Since the commands are each shown in the form of a symbolic image, we'll add one instance of sequencer table item image list for each sequencer table widget. The property image prefix of the sequencer table item image list widget is used to define where the images to be used are stored. To ensure that the correct commands or groups are displayed as images for each table, a number of event bindings must be added. For our example, these have already been added. For information about how the event bindings are structured, see the automation help. A widget-to-widget binding is required in order to add a command selected in the table to the sequence. This is done by binding the property selectedCommandName of the sequencer widget to the property selectedCommandName of the sequencer edit area widget. Now we'll add some more buttons that will allow us to add the commands at specific positions. Insert before will add a command before the selected step. Insert after will add it after the selected step, and so on. Again, the respective event bindings have already been added. For information about how to use them, see the automation help. We're now done configuring the individual widgets. Once our changes have been downloaded onto the controller, we can open the HMI application in a web browser. The sequence can now be displayed and edited via the HMI application. Clicking the Load button loads the specified sequence, and it is now displayed in the editing area of the sequencer. We can now edit the sequence as needed. For example, we could add a new step. To do that, we'll select the hierarchy Basic in the sequencer table. Then we can see the commands that we assigned to hierarchy Basic in part 1 of this tutorial. We'll add the command LED green after the step stop conveyor. To do this, we'll select the desired command in the command table, and then select Stop Conveyor. Using Insert After, we can add LED green after Stop Conveyor. The step has now been added. If we wanted to remove a step, we would simply select it and then click Remove to delete it from the sequence. The modified file can now be saved using the Save button and then imported using Import to Map Sequence. Then it can be started by clicking the Start button. We can use either Map Sequence or the Sequencer Monitor widget to check which step is currently being executed. For information about how to configure and use this widget, see the Automation Help. As you can see, there are many different ways to modify a machine sequence at runtime. You'll find even more examples in the Automation Help. Thanks for watching.